Well, there's a song from 2014, and you might be surprised to know it was from 2014, that is really, really catchy, and I'm wondering if you've ever heard this song before. Clap along if you feel. Do you remember this one? Yeah. Okay. It's a good one. Pharrell, happy, best-selling song of 2014. And I thought that was a typo. Like, no, that was 2019, 28, not 2014. What a great song. I love that song. And I love it because it's just so positive, right? It's so positive, and he's happy, and he's just not going to let anything get in his way. But also, I kind of hate that song, because, like, do you have to keep bragging about it, Pharrell? You get it. You're happy. Stop bragging. The question I want to ask you today is, are you happy? Are you happy? I don't know if anybody is Pharrell happy, but overall, if you look at your life, would you say you're happy? And why? Or why not? Well, a few weeks ago, I was sitting down with my phone and I was making a playlist, a summer playlist. I don't know if you do that, but I go on Amazon Music and I kind of get the songs of the summer, at least for me. And, you know, for me, the songs of the summer typically were written before 1994, but that's just me. And I thought, what is the summer playlist for the church? And it got me thinking about the Psalms. Because the Psalms, I don't know if you know this, are actually songs. They're poems. They were probably sung in different ways with all kinds of different instruments or just a cappella. They were the hymnal of the ancient Jewish people. And they are today still, in many ways, our hymnal, because a lot of our songs are inspired by the Psalms. So I thought, wouldn't it be fun to spend 5 weeks this summer looking at different Psalms, which is our summer playlist? I think that'd be a lot of fun. I'd like to begin with Psalm 1. And Psalm 1 just might be the psalm equivalent of Pharrell's happy. It goes like this. Happy is the one who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers, but whose delight is in the law of the Lord, and who meditates on his law day and night. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now, some of you may have read this psalm before, and you've noticed a few changes in the language. It depends on the version that you read. Some of them say, blessed is the one who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked. Blessed versus happy. And I'm not quite sure why some versions have the word blessed, because the word is the word for happy. We have a word for blessed, or they did anyway, and that's not the word used here. I wonder if some people thought happy, it's not spiritual to be happy. It's spiritual to suffer. It's spiritual to endure. We can get blessings, but we can't be happy. But the word, I mean, I'm sorry, the word is happy. And why can't we be happy? Why not? Does God want us to be miserable? Is that his plan for us? I've heard before that Christians are to be joyful, not happy. And I can understand that. And I also understand that we often go through difficult times. We often go through times that just aren't that happy. And some of you are going through one of those times right now. I'm not suggesting that you need to be delighted or happy about the difficult time you're going through. And neither is the psalmist. But while we do go through difficult times, and life isn't always a bed of roses, I think that God, at least from time to time, wants us to experience moments of happiness. And why do I think that? Well, because this psalm, which is the very first psalm, and it sets the table for all the psalms that are to come, it begins with the secret to happiness. It begins with the secret of how to be happy. But here's the thing, church. It may not be exactly what you think. It may not be. Now, how do most of us seek out happiness? How do most of us go about looking for happiness in our lives? Or as the Americans would say, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. I don't know about you, but this is what I do, and I think a lot of people do this as well. I think most of us strive after happiness by creating a picture in our mind of what it would look like to be happy. Things in our lives that we would need in order to be happy. And so maybe for you that picture is a new car. If I just had a new car, a reliable car, a car with air-conditioned seats, which let me tell you are an amazing invention, then I'd be happy. Actually, for me, a necessity in a car nowadays is dual climate controls. You know what I mean? That means my wife can crank it to high and I can crank mine to low and we remain married. Maybe that picture is a new job. If I could just get out of this place where no one appreciates me, if I could just find a new job, then I'd finally be happy. Maybe it's a new relationship. I just need a little love. If I could find someone who appreciates me for me, or if I could buy that new house, or if I could get that degree, that education, we build these pictures in our mind of what a happy Alton, right? What a happy Marilyn, what a happy Al would look like. And then we strive after obtaining this picture. But what happens? What happens? You tell me, what happens when you don't achieve this picture of happiness? What happens? Well, then you can't be happy. It's a simple equation. If I need these things to be happy and I can't obtain them, at least not in the time frame I'd like, then I can't be happy. Now let me ask you another question, and this one might be a little bit more real. What happens when you do achieve these things? When you get that new car, and you smell that new car smell. How wonderful is that? Until the new car smell wears off, and somebody at the IGA opens their door into yours, leaves a nice big ding in the door. Or that new relationship. You're on top of the world for a date, for 100 dates maybe, but eventually you will fight over the climate controls in your car and the shine is worn off. You see, we're caught. We're caught. If we don't get the things that we picture in our minds that will make us happy, we can't be happy. We get the things we picture in our minds that will make us happy, and guess what? They only make us happy for a short amount of time. And this is why I am an Amazon Prime member. Because every time I get depressed, I can buy something on Amazon, and it will be at my door the next day. And for 30 seconds, I'll be happy. You can substitute Amazon for whatever it is in your life that you find makes you happy for 30 seconds. Now, Psalm 1, it gives us a totally, totally different paradigm for being happy. It goes completely off the map from what most of us do. It doesn't begin with things that we need to gain. It begins with things we need to avoid. Happy is the one who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked. Some versions will say, who does not walk in step with the wicked, which is sort of a metaphor for the counsel of the wicked. Happy is the one who does not stand in the way that sinners take. Happy is the one who does not sit in the company of mockers. The path to happiness, according to Psalm 1, is not by things that you gain, it's by things that you give up, that you leave behind. I read an interesting commentary this week, and it kind of broke it down like this. The three things to avoid is the wrong thinking, the counsel of the wicked, wrong behaving, which is the way that sinners take, and wrong belonging. This is the pathway to unhappiness. Now, I want you to note that it begins in the mind. It begins in the mind with a simple thought. What will it hurt? Who's going to know? Maybe just this once. So your pathway to unhappiness, it begins in the mind. Your thought life is so powerful. Your thought life is more powerful than you can possibly realize. And we don't spend enough time thinking or talking about it. So the question is, who or what is informing your thoughts? Media? Advertising, conspiracy theorists on Reddit? Who do you listen to? Fox News? The Toronto Star? What's your source for information? Where do you seek your counsel? You know, seeking wise counsel, it's become a lost art. It really has. I don't know if it's because now we get on our phone and we can Google any information we want, but we've lost the art of seeking wise counsel. And we tend to stray to one of two extremes. The first extreme is I don't listen to anybody. Do you know some people like that in your life? Your heart breaks for them because they won't listen to anybody, and if they did, they could avoid so much heartache, right? And the other is listening to everybody. Somebody who just can't figure out what direction their life should take, and everybody is speaking into their life, and they're kind of stuck. There is a Danish proverb, I don't know if you've heard of it, he who builds according to every man's advice will have a crooked house. And that's true. The more you walk in the counsel of the wicked, the more your thoughts get twisted. And before you know it, you've come to accept as truth what you once knew was a lie. So the question is, who or what is informing your thoughts? Now, it begins up here in your thoughts, but it moves down to action. Those small thoughts, they become small deeds. Maybe a small lie that turns into a bigger lie. Or maybe you create a secret dating profile that turns into an affair. Or you think, you know what? I'm just going to do coke on weekends. Monday to Friday, I'll stay clean. And before you know it, it's taken over your life. What grew as a twisted idea in the mind is now becoming your twisted reality. Can you see how this is the pathway to unhappiness? I was told long, long time ago by a professor in seminary who said, every affair has always begun in the mind. I think he's right. The path to unhappiness begins in the mind, and then it trickles down into our actions. After a while, what happens? Well, we become rooted. We become rooted in that thought life and in those actions. Your thoughts and your actions are now firmly entrenched in that which you once called the territory of the wicked. You switch sides. And you didn't even know it was happening. And you may scoff at your former life, or you may even scoff at those who take a different path. You might even talk about how ignorant people of faith are for upholding such outdated morals or ideals, because in your mind, you are wise, and you are pursuing the path to happiness. But if you are really honest with yourself, I think you'll find that you are miserable. Nobody sets out in life hoping to deal meth for a living. Nobody. No little girl dreams about a string of failed relationships that cause her bitterness and pain, heartbreak. No little boy says, "When I grow up, I want to be an abusive husband and father." Nobody. The problem is, we chase after the wrong things. We chase after the wrong things. We chase after happiness. And here's the thing. The more you chase after happiness, the further from it you become. You get that? It's ironic, isn't it? The more you chase after happiness, the more unhappy you become. The less you will find it, and the further you are willing to go to try and grab a hold of it. And that's the real problem with this model for finding happiness, is how desperate eventually we will become if we don't find what we're looking for. We become eventually enslaved to the pursuit of happiness. You become stuck, like you're in quicksand, rooted, as I've put on the screen, in unhappiness. Thus, happy is the one who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers, but whose delight is in the law of the Lord, and who meditates on it day and night. You see, the scriptures, they give us a different pathway, a different way of achieving happiness. And oddly, it doesn't involve chasing happiness at all. Instead, the psalmist encourages us to pursue Torah. Pursue Torah. What a strange thing. I want to be happy. Okay, the psalmist says, pursue Torah. Well, what's Torah? Well, Torah it means law, and in the context of the writers of Psalm 1, it could refer to a very specific Mosaic law, thou shalt not kill, or it can refer to simply God's written word as a whole, God's revealed word as a whole, even God's teachings summed up in Scripture. Now, this one's going to be a little tough for those of us who don't really like reading our Bible. So I'm already sorry. Okay, I'm going to apologize if you don't like reading your Bible. But here's the thing, at least according to Psalm 1, the key to happiness is meditating on the law of God. The key to happiness is meditating on the law of God. Why is that? Well, it's pretty simple, right? When you meditate on the law of God, you get your head right. And when you get your head right, you get your actions right. When you get your actions right, you get your company right. And when you get all of that right, you get your whole self right. Right? All of a sudden, along comes happiness. Here's the thing. This is the secret. The more you pursue God's plan for your life, the more you pursue God's ways, the happier you will be. It's almost like happiness just kind of tags along. And let's face it, we live in a world that has really never been farther from God in a long, long time. And we face an epidemic of people who are depressed and anxious and unhappy. And they have some real good reasons to be that way. And people are overwhelmed. and those trying to help those people are overwhelmed. It's an epidemic. And yet, never before have we had such freedom or luxury, have we? We can get in our cars, and we can go wherever we want, whenever we want. It's just that easy. We have all of the collective knowledge of the entire world in a tiny little rectangle in our hands. I can Google the answer to just about anything, even calculus, within seconds. If we get sick, if we're out of work, well, at least for a little while, the government steps in and it helps us out. That didn't happen 300 years ago. You're out of luck. We have the best healthcare the world has ever known. As much as we like to complain about the healthcare system, we are the most advanced. And I don't know about you, but I personally never pay a dime. Between movies and video games and sporting events, casinos and theme parks and all-inclusive Caribbean cruises, we have never been entertained before quite like we are now. Entertainment is limitless. And yet, we are miserable. Just ask people, are you happy? Are you happy? Well, if you're not happy, let me suggest that a small change can lead to big results. A small change can lead to huge results. Because the psalmist continues, happy is the one whose delight is in the law of the Lord, and who meditates on his law day and night. That person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers. It's a small change, really. Most people scoff at the notion that a book can make any significant change. They scoff at the idea even that this is worth reading at all. But friends, this is so much more than a book. This is God's love letter to all of us. This is thousands of years of human experience with God and with themselves. There is wisdom and poetry, and as we said, music, there is history. There is so much in this book. More than that, the Holy Spirit is within these pages, continually pointing us to Christ, our Savior and our Redeemer. From the very opening pages when God says, let us create God, man in our image, to the closing chapters of Revelation where we know that Christ will return again. God's wisdom and his message for the church, for the whole world, is in this book. It's a small change, introducing the regular reading of the word into your life, but it can make a huge difference. Think about small changes for a second. If you plant a tree in the desert, what happens to it? It dries up and it dies. You plant a tree beside a stream of flowing water, that tree, well, it thrives. Just a small choice, but it makes all the difference in the world. That tree puts down deep, deep roots, and it becomes unshakable. So don't think a life that is lived in the Word of God is something to be scoffed at. It is a life that becomes unshakable. And more than that, the psalmist didn't have the advantage of knowing Christ like we do, but when we talk about getting into the Word, we know who is the Word, right? Jesus Christ himself, the revealed Word of God, who is the fulfillment of the law, the Torah, and the prophets. And this whole book points towards him, the whole thing. So we have not only the written word, but the revealed Torah, the Son of God, in our lives. Well, I want to move on because time is quickly running out for us, but I want to bring this little quote to you. Christians who move the world are those who don't let the world move them. And these days, I think it's so easy to let the world move us. But Christians who move the world are rooted deeply in the Word of God. You see, whatever shapes a person's thinking, it shapes their life. And if God, who designed and shaped you for a purpose, is the one you listen to most, well, then you will be, as some versions say, blessed. Your right thinking will give way to right action and then right company until one day you will stand in the company of the angels of heaven around the throne of God, singing unto God Most High, hallelujah. Happy is the one who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked. Happy is the one who meditates on the law of God. Well, I'm going to skip down a little bit to the end of the psalm. Because what happens, and where we often go so wrong, is that we know that the Word of God is powerful. And we desire to read it. And we want to be happy. But you notice that it says the tree produces its fruit in season. And let's be honest, some of us don't want to wait until September. We don't want to wait until October. We want to be happy now. We live in a world that likes immediate answers and immediate action, and we want it now. We grow weary waiting for the fruitful season. But listen, when you start at the gym in January, right? On January 1st, right? And it's great, and you have every intention of going to the gym every day, January 1st, right through to December 31st. But sometime around February 1st, that gym membership becomes just a $30 bill on your credit card, and you never see the inside of that gym ever again. Trust me, I know it's all too real. You won't make gains unless you're committed. Unless you're into that gym on a regular basis. And the same goes for us. We can't allow the Spirit of God to change our minds and change our thinking unless we're regularly in the Word of God. It's just that simple. And so, church, I encourage you to read God's Word, to meditate upon it, to allow it to shape you from the inside out. Because the secret is this: happiness doesn't come from the outside. It begins on the inside as we allow the Spirit of God to work in us and through us. As the Apostle Paul would write to the Galatians, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. And I don't know about you, but if I had all those things in my life, I'd probably be what? Happy. Happy. And finally, the psalm ends on a less happy note. Not so the wicked, the psalmist says. They are like chaff the wind blows away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked leads to destruction. Well, this isn't a happy way to end the psalm on happiness. But this is what they're saying. In the end, only goodness remains. In the end, only love remains. The fruit of the Spirit, it remains. Evil has no place in God's final plan. And so somehow through Jesus Christ and somehow through God's plan, he is working about to bring a reality where there is no evil, where there is no pain. There's no suffering, Revelation 21. Evil has no place in God's final plan. And all the vain things that we chase with such enthusiasm, all those things that we think will make us happy, well, they will simply crumble and they will blow away. But happy is he and happy is she whose delight is in the law of the Lord. Dear church, I pray that you would be blessed. I pray that you would be happy. Let us pray.